Good morning, girls. I'm sorry that I can't be with you today. I really wanted to be there in person. And I accidentally told Justine that I was going to be here this Sunday, but this is fine because it's working out as I'm videotaping him. Justine asked me to share a couple different chapters from the book that we've been sharing or that we've been studying. Every young woman's battle. She asked me to talk on two different chapters today. And I am going to do that, but first I want to set up what I'm going to say from Scripture. I understand that some of the things that I'm going to talk about today are controversial, and I have been praying that God will give me the words to say, the gentleness within to say them, that I'll have clarity, that He will direct my speech. I have also been praying for you, that you'll have ears to hear and hearts that are sensitive to the Holy Spirit and to what the Word of God says. I want to open up with a passage from Titus 2 that I've been studying a lot over the last few years. It addresses older women teaching younger women. It also discusses older men and younger men. And bondservants, but what I'm focusing on today is the relationship between an older woman and the younger women. Obviously, I am the older woman in this case, and you are the younger women. And I'm saying this in love because I love you, and I want you to learn so that you won't have the heartaches or the mistakes that some of us leaders have made. Or we also want you to have maybe the triumphs or and the and the victories that some of us as leaders have had based on our relationship with the Lord and how He has helped turn our lives around or has helped keep us from sin. In Titus 2, 1 through 5, it talks about using sound doctrine as the basis for older women, older men teaching those that are younger. It also gives it gives some characteristics of older men and younger, or older men and women. They're to be temperate, dignified, sensible, sound in faith, in love, and in perseverance. It says older women likewise. They are to be reverent in their behavior, not malicious gossips, nor enslaved to much wine, teaching what is good so that they may encourage the younger women. Again, I'm focusing on the sound doctrine. So what I want to do today is use sound doctrine, which is the Word of God, it's truth, to explain to you why every young woman's battle is saying what the author is saying, what she is saying, and then also from my views, why I am saying what I'm saying. The next passage I want you to turn to is 1 Thessalonians 4, 3 through 8. I'm going to touch on this briefly now and then go into it a little bit more in detail in the second chapter that I'm going to be discussing. Four, it says, "For this is the will of God, your sanctification. That is, that you abstain from sexual immorality, that each of you know how to possess his own vessel in sanctification and honor, not in lustful passion like the Gentiles who do not know God, and that no man transgress and defraud his brother in the matter, because the Lord is the avenger in all these things." Verse 7, I'm just going to end with verse 7. "For God has not called us for the purpose of impurity, but in sanctification." So many of you are wondering, what is God's will for my life? What is God's will for my life? Well, one huge step that you can know for certain right now, no matter if you know what you want to be when you're 30 or you have no idea. The will of God is your sanctification. What is sanctification? Sanctification is being set apart from sin to holiness. So that is what God desires for you, is to be set apart from sin to holiness. I'll go into that passage a little bit more later. I want you to turn to 1 Timothy 2, 9 through 10. And that's the one that I want to focus on. Right now, it says, "Likewise, I want women to adorn themselves with proper clothing, modestly and discreetly, not with braided hair and gold or pearls or costly garments, but rather by means of good works, as is proper for women making a claim to godliness. It says, likewise, I want women to adorn themselves. That word in the Greek means to put in proper order or to decorate. So Paul is assuming that as women, we like to decorate ourselves. We love to dress up and look beautiful and feel beautiful. So he's not denying us to decorate ourselves, but he is putting qualifications on how we decorate ourselves. He says, with proper clothing, modestly. Those words, it's also propriety is another word in other translations. It has the connotation of being mixed with humility. So when you are dressing in the morning, you are viewing your outfit that you're putting on with humility. You are rejecting things that are dishonorable to God. When you're choosing the outfit, you know, you need to be asking yourself, is this outfit going to honor or dishonor God? As later on in the verse, it says, as is proper for women making a claim to godliness. Can we make a claim to godliness when I'm putting on this outfit? The next word that it says, with proper clothing, modestly and discreetly. Discreetly in other translations can be translated moderation, sobriety. This means self-control over sexual passions. So when you're getting dressed in the morning, are your thoughts, how sexy do I look? Or are you considering how discreet can I be in my dress? And discreet, one of the definitions for discreet is beautiful. We're not saying make yourself look ugly and unattractive. Discreet is beautiful. But are you doing it with self-control over your sexual passions? John MacArthur says, godly women hate sin and control their passions as not to lead another into sin. And that is kind of my segue into the first chapter that I'm going to talk about. And it is Dress to Impress. Who are you trying to impress when you're dressing in the morning? When you're choosing an outfit, are you choosing an outfit trying to catch the attention of a hot guy at school or of someone, you know, in one of your clubs or at, you know, in the church youth group at Gap? What is your motivation for picking out the outfit that you are picking out? I want you to turn to Romans 13, verse 14. This verse says, rather, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think of how to gratify the desires of the sinful nature. Okay, you might say, Wendy, clothe yourself with the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, that's not really giving me any direction here. So I'm gonna kind of parse this out a little bit. Okay, so do not think about how to gratify the desires of the sinful nature. Okay, what are the desires of the sinful nature? A big source of sin would be pride. When you are getting dressed in the morning, do you look at yourself in the mirror? And you're like, oh my goodness, I look good today. And not just in a, oh my goodness, I look like I was made in the image of God kind of look, like, you know what I'm talking about. Or you might look in the mirror and say, you know, oh, this outfit is, you know, hugging those curves in just the right way. Or, you know, maybe showing this feature off or this feature or whatever. Are you proud of how you are looking in your outfit and you know that you look good, so you picked that outfit? Maybe another sinful nature characteristic would be jealousy. Are you choosing the outfit that you are going to wear because you are jealous of the attention a guy is giving to another girl and you think if I wear this outfit, he will give me more attention than that girl? Or idolatry. Do you have such a deep desire for acceptance from others, or you want to fit into a certain group at all costs, that you are willing to give up your modesty to fit in with that group or to look like you are current with, you know, the latest fashions? Another one is immoral or sexual sinful desires. You know, when you put on an outfit, are you thinking, oh, this is going to draw this guy's attention? He will think I look so sexy. Or, you know, whatever the thoughts are going through your head, like, I will surely draw him in with this outfit. If those are some of the thoughts, and I'm sure that there's dozens and dozens of other thoughts, sinful desires. If those are some of your thoughts, I want you instead to consider this verse. And please turn with me to this verse. Colossians 3, 12 and 14. Therefore, as God's chosen people, in this, in our case, God's chosen daughters, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. So when you get dressed in the morning, instead of looking at yourself in the mirror in pride, jealousy, idolatry, or you know, having sexual thoughts, instead, given the fact that we know that men are visual creatures, that they're visually stimulated, are you acting as this verse says, with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, and love as you wear the clothes that you wear? So now we're going to get to the painful part. I love you all. Please remember that when I'm saying this. Okay, the first one we're going to look at is rompers. They are pretty. They're feminine. They are billowy in the summer. But when you are trying them on in the store or you're taking one out of your closet currently, I want you to ask yourself, where would a guy's eyes be drawn when I'm wearing this? I'm going to be showing you pictures as I'm sharing this. When I looked at girls wearing rompers, or I've seen some of these pictures, a lot of the time their rompers are super short. Sometimes the top is very low and loose. Frequently rompers are so loose that if you move in a wrong way, then the whole room is seeing your undergarments or maybe your lack of undergarments. So when you're wearing a romper, just be mindful of where a guy's eyes would be being drawn. Are they being drawn to your face, your beautiful face and your hair? Or are they being drawn down to your neckline or to your upper thigh? So just be mindful when you're wearing that. Again, you know, the Colossians 3 passage, just ask yourself that. Shift dresses. I know many of you, don't groan when I'm saying this, many of you wear shift dresses, and I am not completely downing them. They're feminine. You feel pretty when you wear a dress. However, again, I'm going to ask you, where are a guy's eyes drawn when you're wearing a shift dress? Many times I've seen girls in them. They're very short. They're swingy so that if the wind is blowing or if you're moving fast or something happens, then they can very easily bounce up and show undergarments or whatever. And you could say, oh, but Wendy, I wear spandex. Good. I'm so glad that you were in spandex because, oh my goodness. If you weren't, then I would really worry. However, a shift dress, if it is a short, especially the shorter ones, will allow for wandering and questioning eyes to not be satisfied by just looking, and they will possibly be lusting in their mind, and you do not want to be the cause of a guy lusting. Here's another one where you guys are going to hate me. A bikini or two-piece. I heard many years ago that just because you look good in something doesn't mean that you should wear it. What is your purpose in wearing a bikini? They leave very little to the imagination. If it's to fit in, again, I want you to ask yourself, is my self-image an idol in my life? Why am I wearing this swimsuit? is it to get attention from guys? Is it to get even attention from my other girlfriend so that they see how good I look? Either one of those is not a good reason for wearing them. I will continue. Bralettes. Okay. Bras. A bralette is a bra. A bra is an undergarment. I think that I'm correct in saying it's an undergarment. It's supposed to go under. However, when you wear bralettes, it draws your attention to the fact that you are showing off your bra. This, like I said, maybe is controversial. I just want you to consider, when you are putting on what you are wearing, why am I wanting to show this off? What is my purpose in wanting to show off what I am, what I'm wearing? The next sore subject I'm going to bring up is prom dresses. Again, I'm going to ask the question, where are a guy's eyes being drawn? Are they being drawn to the short hemline that might accidentally get pushed up during a dance? Or is your back completely bare, letting everyone know that you're not wearing a bra, which for some guys is a total turn on? And maybe I should say most guys. Or is a slit so high that all the guys are just hoping that you might just turn just right so they can get a glimpse of something underneath? Or does it plunge so low that you're falling out, that you need to be careful of your every move, and everyone's trying to look down your, or all the guys are trying to look down your dress the whole night? So again, does your prom dress pass the Colossians 3 test? And just some additional, I'm not going to pick on any more outfits, but just some additional questions and thoughts I want for you guys to consider regarding modesty. When you're wearing a skirt, are you sitting modestly? There was a couple years ago, there was a girl here in the youth group that was sharing on stage. She was wearing shorts underneath her. Shorts underneath her dress. However, she was sitting with her legs wide apart so that some of the guys ended up passing a message along to Lee, who passed a message on to me, and it just needed to tell her, hey, you're on stage and everyone can see up your skirt. Or is your skirt see-through? This is going to sound so old-fashioned, but do you need a slip under your dress? I've seen many girls out in the sunlight, you can see completely through their dress, which leaves nothing to the imagination, and guys don't have to even imagine anything. They can just see right through. Or is your shirt so low, and maybe some of you guys don't think about this, is your shirt so low or just loose enough that when you bend over that you can see down your shirt? And that is something, especially since having Joshua, that I've really had to reconsider some of the clothing in my wardrobe and just being way more aware of, you know, when you're running after a crawling baby or when you're holding him and he's pulling on your shirt. So this is something I've had to readdress for myself, and I am admittedly still not there because I'm still finding outfits that end up being completely immodest after Joshua is showing everything of mine off. Or when you bend over, are your pants low enough so that your underwear are showing when you bend over in the back? Or, you know, when you're wearing a skirt and you bend over, can everyone, like, is the skirt going almost all the way up to your underwear line? Again, any of those circumstances, they are not being kind to a man's eyes. And just please consider being kind and compassionate, gentle, patient, loving when you're dressing yourself in the morning. You can also ask this question, what is my purpose in wearing this? Am I being loving to my Christian brothers in this outfit? Okay, I'm done with the modesty section. My next one is to flirt or not to flirt. I want you to open up to 1 Thessalonians 4, 3 through 8. We discussed this one earlier. Again, this is the will of God is your sanctification, which is, again, being set apart from sin to holiness. You're saying, Wendy, what does this have to do with flirting? Well, verse 4 says, to possess your body in sanctification and not in passionate lust. Verse 5 says, do not defraud or take advantage of your brother. So you might say, Wendy, flirting. I'm just having fun. I'm just fooling around. Maybe I shouldn't say fooling around. I'm just, we're just joking around, having fun together. But it says, these verses say specifically, possess your body in sanctification. What is sanctification? It's setting yourself apart from sin unto God, unto holiness. If you are not setting yourself apart from sin and apart from lust, then what are you setting yourself? If you are not setting yourself apart to holiness through your actions, then what are you setting yourself apart to? And I would have to say that you're setting yourself apart to some sort of sinful nature, whether that's pride or lust or something. So you say, okay, Wendy, I'm just flirting. We're having fun. But remember, girls are emotional beings, and sometimes we tend to let our emotions take over. I want you to ask yourself these questions. Is what I'm saying or how I am acting, is it beneficial? Or am I leading a guy on or alienating a girlfriend by my talk with a specific guy? Flirting can not only harm your relationship with guys in the long term, it can also harm your relationship with your good girlfriends. And I have talked to some of you whom this has happened to. So I know I'm speaking the truth. I love you. Another question. Am I manipulating this guy in order to meet my own personal emotional needs and make me feel better about myself? I'm going to give you a personal life example of this one. I had come back from, as many of you know, I went to Appalachian Bible College for a couple of years. When I came back, there was also a friend of mine who was a couple years younger than me from my youth group who had also, he had finished, he had come back from school. And we had no friends. Like, it was just me and this guy. Barely any of our friends, most of our other friends had moved away. And so I was under the assumption that we were just having a fun, playful brother-sister relationship. We hung out a lot, one-on-one. He would come sometimes and see me at work. I would go over to his family's house and hang out. I'd go over to his parents' house for dinner after church on Sundays. From my perspective, I was having a playful, fun relationship with a guy, and it was meeting my emotional needs for friendship at the time. I was not being thoughtful of how my actions might have been leading him on. At a family dinner, when I was at his house for a dinner one night, all of a sudden he's like, oh, I have to go. And he jumped up out of the table and started going out the door. I was like, oh, that's kind of weird. Like, why are you leaving? He's like, I can't tell you. And he just walked out the door. And his family looked at me. They're like, you don't know why he's leaving? They're like, he's going to go talk to your dad and ask if he can date you. And I was furious that no one had said anything to me. Although for months I had led this guy on, I just thought it was, you know, harmless. And now he had completely taken things seriously and was going about it the right way to go talk to my dad and ask him to date me. So then I spent months trying to undo, the next couple months trying to undo all of my flirtatious behavior towards him and try to convince him that we didn't belong together and that I didn't like him. But after flirting with him for months, for going on dates with him for months, for, you know, giving long front hugs for months and all of a sudden telling him, no, I don't really like you, of course he was confused. And I ended up breaking his heart, and for years he talked about it, which made me feel absolutely terrible for what I had done. So, but I used him to meet an emotional friendship need and did not keep boundaries with that relationship. And that's one of my regrets to this day. Other forms of flirting. Sarcasm. You know, you can joke around, whatever, but that can be flirting too. Physical touch, hugging. Please, please do not give front hugs. You can tent hug, which is the whole like tent hug. It's kind of awkward to tent hug the air when there's no one else there. But when you are front hugging a guy, you are pressing your breasts up against him. And he likes that. But you shouldn't want him to like that, because you are wanting him and yourself to be sexually pure. You are wanting to love him as a Christian brother, or maybe as a non-Christian friend. That is not what you want him to be using you for. Punching or wrestling. With some guys, that's super attractive. They like to be physical and like the rough play with a woman. But is that a characteristic of a discreet woman? I think a big life-changing moment for me, I was in my mid-20s, and I had this kind of a relationship with a guy. Again, in my mind, it was completely a brother-sister relationship, but I started hearing rumors that other people did not view it that way. He had a girlfriend, and we had just had this relationship, and I ended up having to go up to him and apologize to him for how I had been interacting. That completely changed my behavior towards guys in general, because I realized if I'm going to have to keep going up to guys and apologizing for the way I'm interacting with them, that could get really embarrassing and really old and mean that I'm not, and if I keep doing it, then obviously that means that I'm not really sorry for what I'm doing. And that was a big life-changing moment when I realized that my actions were not being discreet or thoughtful of other men. Late night talks. The later it gets, the more our mouths start going and the looser our tongues get, and we say more things than we should say. Be very careful of late night talks with guys. Late night talks with girls, much better. Still can start gossiping and stuff, but focus on or try not to have late night talks with guys. Late night texting sessions, whatever. Okay, I'm going to end with this. If you are looking for male attention, as I spoke a couple weeks ago, you need to retrain your heart and your mind to be focused on our Lord Jesus Christ. If a guy is telling you that he's enthralled or that he thinks that you are gorgeous and the sexiest woman he knows, remember Psalm 45:11 says God is enthralled by your beauty. If a guy says he's going to love you forever, first of all, don't believe him, unless he's your husband. Jeremiah 31:3, God has loved you with an everlasting love. That's beautiful. Like that means that he loved you before time began, he loves you now, and he loves you in the future. And will always, always love you. Hebrews 13:5, God will never leave you or forsake you, even when you're married and you're making wedding vows. Just keep in mind that God will never leave you and never forsake you. And death can never separate you from God, Romans 8:38 and 39. Again, we need to retrain our minds to be focused on the Lord. Psalm 19:14. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. When you're interacting with guys, let the words of your mouth be edifying to them. Be words of compassion and gentleness. When you are meditating in your heart, don't be thinking of how you can get that guy's attention. But how you can glorify God through that relationship. This might sound pie in the sky, but ladies, the sooner you get this, the better it is. The less regrets you will have in your life, the more glory you can bring to the Lord through your relationships with your girlfriends and with your guy friends. Ladies, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. Love the Lord first, and love your neighbor second. make sure that the guys that you're loving in your life, you're loving like you would love the Lord. I love you all. Please don't hate me, and I would love to hear feedback. Please text me if you have questions, or meet with me after I get back. I'll be back on Thursday. I love you all. Have a good rest of your day.